Welcome to Byte Size. In today's episode, we're talking about computer clock speeds. Computers are like little clockwork devices. A clock strikes a beat, and a certain small amount of work gets done. Just like the beginning piano player plays to the beat of a metronome, computers run to the beat of an electronic clock. If you set the metronome too fast, the player won't have enough time to find the next piano key and the rendition will fall apart, or at least sound pretty bad. Likewise, if you set the clock rate of a CPU too high, it will malfunction and the system will crash. This won't necessarily damage the chip, it just won't work. Part of a computer's design includes determining the optimum clock rate. In some ways, the clock is like the coxswain of a rowing team. He or she is the person who holds up the megaphone and chants, "Stroke, stroke, stroke." If the order is issued too quickly, the rowers will get out of sync and the boat will slow down. In that sense, the coxswain is restricted in dishing out commands no faster than the slowest rower. In a PC, many chips work to the beat of a computer's clock, and that means the clock can't run faster than the slowest component, which happens to be the most complex ones, usually the CPU or memory, although they can run on independent clocks. The negotiation between CPU and memory was originally performed by the memory controller hub. This later became the Northbridge chip, and most recently can be found integrated into the CPUs themselves. The clock rate is usually determined by the frequency of an oscillator crystal, similar to the crystal in your watch. This produces a sine wave, which is translated by electronic circuitry into a square wave. And from there we can get binary commands, either the wave is on or off. After each clock pulse sent scooting through the circuitry in varying directions, depending on the commands given, the signal lines inside the CPU need time to settle into their new state, meaning a transition either from 0 to 1 or 1 to 0. If the next clock pulse comes too quickly, then the results will be out of sync and incorrect. It's the process of transitioning that produces the heat, and therefore the higher the clock rate or number of transitions calculated within a second, the more heat is produced. Originally, CPU clocks were measured in hertz and kilohertz, with 1 kilohertz being 1,000 ticks per second. Then, in the 80s and 90s, CPU clocks generally ticked at more than 1,000,000 times per second, which equates to a 1 megahertz clock speed. Early PCs and XTs used a 4.77 megahertz clock, and the AT originally harnessed a 6 megahertz clock. These processors didn't yield a lot of heat and generally didn't require heat sinks to dissipate the excess energy. Of course, in more recent times, we're more familiar with gigahertz, 1 gigahertz equating to a clock tick of 1,000 million times per second. Now that's some pretty mean progress, and also a significant increase in heat energy. For many years, the maximum possible CPU speed determined a lot about the rest of the computer. Usually, a manufacturer would design a motherboard to operate at the same speed as the CPU. When CPUs rose in speed from 5 MHz to 8 MHz, motherboards followed suit. All of the chips on the board had to be 8 MHz chips, including the memory. This was not only expensive, but it was pretty impossible at the time to push from over 8 MHz. So since 1984, motherboards have been designed so that different parts can run at different speeds. Now this does mean that some speed is wasted, but compromises must be met. Like processor speed, motherboard speeds move with the times, and in 1989, motherboard speeds had been pushed to 33 MHz. With Intel's 50 MHz 486 processor on the scene, this meant a new strategy was required for the CPU to work with these still slower boards. The original clock doubler was a special 486 that could plug straight into a 25 MHz board and cooperate at that speed externally, but internally ran at 50 MHz. This meant that numeric calculations or internal data transfer was carried out at double speed, but external operations were queued up at the 25 MHz rate. A 66 MHz 486 was developed to also plug straight into 33 MHz boards. This trend continued as processors got faster and faster than motherboards, the clock triplers, quadruple, and today's boards tend to run at several hundred megahertz, with that speed factored up to match the CPU speed. As some boards allow, overclocking your motherboard front side bus or its multiplication factor will therefore increase the speed of your CPU. In modern multi-core processors, each core runs at its own clock rate. So what then do these cycles of pulses mean? how does a cycle of electrons whizzing about translate to what you see on your screen? Well, let's take a 1 kHz clock rate. Now, a CPU running at this speed can flick each of its binary switches 1000 times every second. So, after receiving input that flicks these switches into a certain configuration, the CPU will then produce a result which can be cached and used on its next cycle. This continues, and once enough of these results have been determined, we will have an instruction. It's this instruction that might tell the computer to place a pixel into memory, for example. Then cycle by cycle, instruction by instruction, pixel by pixel, a picture is then pieced together in memory, before a subsequent instruction starts the process of pushing that picture onto our screens. Now, the number of cycles required per instruction depends on what program you're trying to execute or how the CPU is built, and it's more likely that we would now be dealing with instructions per cycle rather than cycles per instruction, simply due to the vast amounts of data a CPU can now handle and compute within each single cycle. A typical Core i7 can generally compute over 100,000 million instructions per second, from a clock speed of just 3,000 million cycles per second, or 3 GHz. This instruction rate is really what determines how fast a given program will execute. Now, take the first electronic general purpose computer, the ENIAC. Had a 100 kHz clock rate, and each instruction took 20 cycles, leading to an instruction rate of 5 kHz, or 5,000 instructions per second. Of course, due to the varying ways processors are built and handle data, and the fact that different tasks will massively impact how many instructions are completed in a given time frame, it's far easier for us to compare processor speed in cycles per second rather than instructions per second, or millions of instructions per second, known as MIPS, which are generally now just used for task speed benchmarking. So there we are, that's how lights and clockwork run your computer.